Good morning.
Good morning.
It's great to welcome you again to a beautiful Sabbath morning. Remember, radio station is 95.9 if you want to listen on your car radio. Hopefully you are able to hear things on the speaker as well if car radio is not the way you want to hear. Would you bow your heads for a word of prayer? God of abundant mercy, we have come seeking your hospitality, that we might be equipped to welcome others. We reach for those high standards of commitment which you call forth, that we may not back down from the call to faithful living.
Boys and girls, it's Miss D with your Sunday school lesson. I'm sitting here in my car, in my driveway, and I'm thinking about being patient. Have you ever been on a long trip and said something like, "Are we there yet? Are we there yet?" I know I have. And that's an example of not being patient. So, God gave us a spirit of being patient. But how can we be patient when we have to wait? Well, we can play games. Like I spy. I spy with my little eye something orange. Well, it's a kitty cat, of course. Or maybe we can practice our math facts. We can count to 100 by five. Or very simply, just say a quick prayer and ask God to help you be more patient. Happy Sunday.
Let us bring to God all the brokenness of our lives, our alienation from our Creator, from persons we are called to love, and even from our own best selves. Let us pray. We confess, merciful God, that we speak words of peace, but our deeds often bring division. Our lips honor you, but our hearts are far from you. We are ready to trust you when life is peaceful and prosperous. But when the storms of life come upon us, we seek our security in the gods of power, money, and prestige. Forgive us and restore us that we might be your faithful people and proclaim once again that you are a God full of mercy and compassion. Hear now with silent prayers and petitions of our hearts. Amen. Give these words of assurance. God meets us face to face and listens to our every longing. In Christ, we are given a refuge and are saved from our deceits. We are free to give up our old ways to walk in newness of life. Let us live then as people who are dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Amen. Our first passage of scripture is from the sixth chapter of the Epistle to the Romans, beginning in the 12th verse. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal bodies so that you obey its evil desires. Do not offer the parts of your body to sin as instruments of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer the parts of your body to him as instruments of righteousness. For sin shall not be your master, because you are no longer under the law, but under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? By no means. Don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone to obey him as slaves, you are slaves to the one whom you obey, whether slaves to sin, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God, that though you used to be slaves to sin, who wholeheartedly obeyed the form of teaching to which you were entrusted, you have been set free from sin, and have now become slaves to righteousness. I put this in human terms because you are weak in your natural selves. Just as you used to offer the parts of your body in slavery to impurity and to ever-increasing wickedness, so now offer them in slavery to righteousness, leading to holiness. When you were slaves to sin, you were free from the control of righteousness. What benefit did you reap at the time from the things that you are now ashamed of? Those things result in death. But now that you have been set free from sin, you have become slaves to God, and the benefits you reap lead to holiness, and the result is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The Holy Gospel is from the Gospel of Matthew chapter 10, verses 40 through 42. He who receives you receives me, and he who receives me receives the one who sent me. Anyone who receives a prophet because he is a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. Anyone who receives a righteous man because he is a righteous man will receive a righteous man's reward. And if anyone gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones because he is my disciple, I tell you the truth, he will certainly not lose his reward. May God bless today the reading, hearing, and understanding of God's holy word. Let us pray. Lord God, open now our hearts and minds to your word, to your teaching, and your scripture. Teach us about hospitality, kindness to our neighbor, and love to those that might be different from us. Lord, we ask it in your name. Amen. Well, the gospel lesson today concludes the 10th chapter, and it's been 3 weeks that we've been reading this 10th chapter of Matthew, but these last two verses are the end of it. And Jesus has encouraged his disciples to go out and to do miraculous things, things that Jesus was doing. And he speaks here about hospitality, about being welcomed and being welcoming. A woman named Mrs. Casey, she was not liked by any of the children in town because she had surgery to remove her nose because she had cancer. Most of the adults in town avoided Mrs. Casey as well. She wore a bandage around her face that covered between her eyes and her mouth, covered the whole area where her nose used to be. And there were times that there was a foul odor that came from this bandage that Mrs. Casey wore. That's why people avoided her. But one woman in this community, one woman, felt like she owed it to Mrs. Casey to continue to be kind because of her faith. She would bake cookies, she would bake bread. Sometimes she would deliver it herself, but more often she would send her son to deliver these baked items to Mrs. Casey. He was not happy about going. He whined to his mother. He tried to get out of it. He explained how sometimes she would smell and he would drop these things off. And his mother just all the more said, well, you're going to go. You're going to drop this off. You're going to take this to Mrs. Casey. Then one day in November, she announced to the family that Mrs. Casey was going to be invited to the family Thanksgiving dinner because she had no family of her own. This young son was very upset. He thought about everything that was going to be shared at Thanksgiving dinner, the turkey, the mashed potatoes, the stuffing, and his favorite, those wonderful yams covered with marshmallow, brown sugar, and nuts. And he said, Mom, Mrs. Casey's presence is going to ruin my Thanksgiving dinner. Will you at least let me sit far away from her? Well, the day came, Thanksgiving Day came, and he was seated directly across the table from Mrs. Casey. And as things began to be passed around the table, those yams were being passed. And the young son was going to be the last to receive the yams. His older brother counted the number of yams in the dish, and he took two, which was a sin. He wasn't supposed to take two. Only took one of everything until everybody was served. But he took two because he knew that there was a guest. And so his parents weren't going to say anything and his brother wasn't going to throw a fit. There would be no yams left for the little brother. The older brother did that. Well, Mrs. Casey was next to receive the yams. She also did the math and saw that there were not enough for everyone. So she passed them by, didn't take any. Passed them around the table until they got to the young son who had delivered the baked goods to her week after week. The young son whose head had been down, he didn't want to look at Mrs. Casey. He raised his head and he saw in the dish one yam. He saw that Mrs. Casey didn't have any. So he carefully took his knife that he hadn't used and he cut the yam in half. And he took it and he handed it to Mrs. Casey. And she smiled. And in that moment, that young boy understood that she was a child of God that needed love just like everyone else. And he understood why his mother was so hospitable, why his mother had invited her to Thanksgiving dinner, why his mother was always making baked goods and having him deliver them. He understood. And Mrs. Casey became a real human being to him that day. Hospitality and Jesus' words this morning from the Gospel of Matthew are about being hospitable to one another, greeting one another, sharing with one another. The last verse says, if anyone gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones because he is my disciple, I tell you the truth, he will certainly not lose his reward. And what is that reward for hospitality, for being a child of God, for being loving towards others? It is eternal life. Which is what the book of Romans told us today. Eternal life. Hospitality. Jesus was the most hospitable example that we could have. Jesus welcomed women, sat and spoke to them when he wasn't supposed to. It was culturally not acceptable for a man alone to speak to a woman alone. He stood by the well and he did just that. Jesus had dinner with sinners. People of all kinds of reputation. All kinds of past deeds that they had done. Jesus went into their home and ate with them. He went to the sick lepers, to the unclean. And he healed them. He touched them. He went against so many cultural norms and Pharisaic practices. Jesus message of love and hospitality to all people, his message of inclusivity to all people, is at the heart of his gospel. We're hospitable people most of the time, especially if people are like us, if they look like us, if they have kind of the same educational level, same economic status as us. We're hospitable. We get along well with those folks. But let it be someone who's a little bit different. I'm going to share a story that Pat Costello shared with me yesterday at Provide a Lunch. He said, you ask 100 people if they think it's a good idea to have a group home for mentally retarded people in their community. And 99 out of 100 will say yes. And then you say to that group, well, good, because we're going to put that group home right next door. Now those 99 that said yes and thought it was a good idea, now all of a sudden it's not a good idea to put that group home right next door to them. And they have all kinds of reasons why not. That's not being hospitable. Jesus has given us an example of hospitality, of radical welcome, of inclusivity to all people. And we are made better when we broaden our horizons and get to know people that are different from us. When we speak to someone who might be mentally challenged, and you find out that they've got gifts and talents and abilities. They've got things that God has blessed them with. They've got a sensitivity and an awareness that we don't have. We can learn from people who are different from us if we will take the time and be hospitable and listen to them and get to know them. Jesus did that. He did that with these sinners. He didn't care about their past. He didn't care about what deeds they had done. What he cared about was moving forward, which is what the book of Romans speaks about today. About a new life, not the past life, where we were under doing bad things. These probably what the writer, what Paul is writing here to the Romans, probably has to do with people offering themselves in sexual practices, sexually immoral behaviors. That's probably what he's addressing here. He says, do not offer the parts of your body to sin as instruments of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God. If we are truly going to be followers of Jesus Christ, we've got to be radically hospitable to all people. Get to know people who are different from ourselves. Get to see them as a child of God. As that young boy found Mrs. Casey to be a child of God around a Thanksgiving dinner table. She wasn't much to behold. She smelled. But she was a child of God. And he realized that. If we listen to others and get to know people who are different from us, we too will see that they are children of God with gifts and talents and abilities just like we have. May hospitality and radical hospitality, the kind that Jesus exemplified, may it be what we do. Amen. Our prayer list this morning. Continued prayers for Barbara Gifford, who has issues with her intestinal tract. Things are not getting better. In fact, she told me this week they are getting worse. So prayers for Barbara. For Laura Wallace, who is going to be needing some surgery. For Michael Spurrier, who is recuperating from double pneumonia. Fred Gross, undergoing more heart tests. For Cindy Miller, who is battling cancer. Dr. Mark Hirsch. For Judy Bachman, who has fallen 4 times in the last, 3 weeks? So if anybody has bubble wrap at home and could offer that to Judy, that would be greatly appreciated. For Ron Rummel, Tom Boylan, for Richard and Dolores Jones, for David Krager. For those that are dealing with end-of-life issues, Darlene Custer called yesterday. Her sister, Janet Golden, had suffered a stroke, and she was in rehab. And Darlene told me that her family was having to make decisions about whether or not to keep her on life support. So prayers for Janet and for Darlene and family. For Wanda Bankard, who is going to be seeing a surgeon this Thursday and hopefully getting a date for her surgery. For Randy Warner, who is in a rehab in Hershey. For Rick Ehring, heart issues. Renee Lawrence, who is a hospice patient. Laura Metzel, who was in a car accident, but prayers have been answered and she is improving. For Tess Naylor, who has broken her arm due to a fall. For Chris and Crystal Miller, Mary Gilbert, LaVon and Marg Lepo. LaVon's having surgery tomorrow and Marg later in the month of July. For Karen, who has a tumor and also has a brain bleed due to a fall. For Nevin Lepo, who is undergoing some heart tests and is going to be having some heart surgery. He sees the cardiologist this week. And for all those that are dealing with mental health issues due to the pandemic, loss of work, all the things that people are facing right now, the economy, for our nation, and for God's world. Prayers of sympathy for the families of Nevin Robinstein, Lila Garrett, Virginia Myers. Virginia was Deb Richards' mother. For Britton Park, that was Doug Seneff's Swedish brother, who was an exchange student that lived with Doug's family. It was his wife. For Theron Hand and the family of Tom Cobb. I again remind you to email, text those prayer concerns. We list them and we keep them all throughout the weeks as we gather. Let us go before God in the spirit of prayer. We thank you, Almighty God, for blessing us with again another beautiful morning. We thank you for all who were able to be with us and for those that are watching this at home later this week. We are grateful for, Lord, the ways technology makes this possible. We continue to pray for safety as the coronavirus is not going away, not subsiding. In fact, in some places it is seeming to be ramping up and becoming more of a problem in those areas. And we pray for just people to be wise in decisions that they make. Help us to take care of each other, as we would certainly not want to be an unwilling carrier of this dreaded disease to a family member or a friend who would succumb to the disease, and then we found out that we were the ones that were taking it to them. Lord, help us to continue to be wise and patient. Patient with one another, as Miss D's message spoke to us today about patience. Help us to have patience and to learn to sit in a car line, sit in a hot parking lot. Lord, to stand in line 6 feet apart. To be patient in getting back to the things that we so much would like to do and be at normal again. We're not used to having these inconveniences in our lives. In fact, we are very blessed here in this country to have so many modern conveniences. And perhaps one of the things that you will have us learn from this is patience again. We pray for all those in our world who are dealing with a variety of issues, not only of health, but of financial stability, for those out of work, for those who are in relationships that are going nowhere, relationships that are abusive, for those who are bent on doing harm and wrong and destructive things, we pray. We pray for ourselves. That you would help us to be a living witness each and every day for you. We ask it, Lord, in your name, praying as you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The words of benediction today come from the 13th chapter of the book of Hebrews. Keep on loving each other, brothers. Do not forget to entertain strangers, for by doing so, some people have entertained angels without knowing it. May our hospitality lead to the welcoming of angels, people who broaden our horizons and teach us new things in our lives. Amen. Before sharing this last hymn, Sally gave to me a hymn story, which is supposed to be true. Do not know the truth of this, but I'm going to read it to you prior to playing the closing hymn. The story of the song is covered in the book by Dr. P.P. Job, an Indian preacher, in his book, Why God, Why? About 150 years ago, there was a great revival in Wales, England. As a result of this, many missionaries came from England and Germany to Northeast India to spread the gospel. At the time, Northeast India was known as Assam and comprised of hundreds of tribes. The tribal communities were quite primitive and aggressive by nature. The tribes were headhunting tribes, and it was their social custom that required male members of the community to collect as many heads as possible. A man's strength and ability to protect his wife was attested to by the number of heads he had collected. Therefore, a youth of marriageable age would try and collect as many heads as possible and hang them on the walls of his house. The more heads a man had, the more eligible he was considered. So it's not about all the toys you have, it was about all the heads you had. Into this hostile and aggressive community came a group of Welsh missionaries spreading the message of love, peace, and hope through Jesus Christ. Naturally, they were not welcomed. One Welsh missionary succeeded in converting a man, his wife, and two children. This man's faith proved contagious, and many villagers began to accept Christianity. Angry, the village chief summoned all the villagers. He then called the family who had first converted to Christ to renounce their faith in public or face execution. Moved by the Holy Spirit, the man instantly composed a song which became famous down through the years, and he sang three times, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Enraged at the refusal of this man, the chief ordered his archers to arrow down this man's two children. As both boys lie twitching on the floor, the chief asked, will you now deny your faith? You have lost your children, and you will lose your wife too. But the man sang these words in reply, though none go with me, still I will follow. No turning back, no turning back. So the chief was beside himself with fury, and he ordered the man's wife to be arrowed down. In a moment, she joined the two children in death. Now he asked for the last time, I will give you one more opportunity to deny your faith and live. In the face of death, the man sang the final memorable line. The world behind me, the cross before me, no turning back, no turning back. The man was shot dead like the rest of his family. But with their deaths, a miracle took place. The chief who had ordered the killings was moved by the faith of this man, and he wondered, why should this man, his wife, and two children die for a man who they did not know? There must be some supernatural power behind this family, and he too wanted that supernatural power. In a spontaneous confession of faith, he declared, I too belong to Jesus Christ. When the crowd heard this from the mouth of their chief, the whole village accepted Christ as their Lord and Savior. This is the power of God being demonstrated.
Be